All right, morning. Thank you very much again for joining us. My name is Mike Sostruck. I'm the Commissioner for the Department of Public Safety here in the state of Maine. We are going to give some further details from an operational standpoint about what happened overnight and kind of where we're going from here. But before we do that, I would like to ask Chief St. Pierre to come back up and join us and kind of touch on the Lewiston experience overall. Chief?
Thank you, Mike, and good morning. Members of the media and the public who are watching closely as law enforcement continues to work diligently on this rapidly evolving investigation. The safety of our community remains paramount. I want to assure all that a tremendous amount of law enforcement manpower, time, and effort is being utilized around the clock, literally around the clock, in every effort to apprehend the suspect as well as to safeguard this community. As the Chief of the Lewiston, Maine Police Department, I am extremely thankful for the community's outpouring of support being offered during this tense and trying time. I extend my deepest appreciation for all of our law enforcement partners who have responded from literally around this nation. Again, I will ask the community to be as patient as possible with this process, realizing that there are many, many moving parts and coordination of efforts involved between multiple agencies. We will attempt to provide as much information possible as this investigation proceeds forward. I would also like to acknowledge and thank the many businesses, restaurant owners, individuals who have provided meals and other essential items to support an investigation of this magnitude. Following this press conference, details will be shared regarding counseling locations, where somebody can make a donation if necessary or asked, and the hosting of several different vigils. On behalf of the hundreds of law enforcement officers who have descended upon our great city over the last 3 days, we want to extend our heartfelt support as well as our sympathies to the victims and families involved in this senseless tragedy. Thank you, and I'll turn it back over to Mike.
Thank you, Chief. I appreciate that. So I guess for starters, I want to make sure that we always take a moment to acknowledge the victims, their families, and how this is negatively impacting the state of Maine, the city of Lewiston, and really our entire country. What we know when these things occur around our country, we are all so incredibly focused on what happened, and then we try to get to the why. And there are certainly times when we can't quite figure out the why, because every one of these situations is so tragic, so outside of the norm, that it makes it difficult for community members of all types in all locations, East Coast, West Coast, it doesn't matter, to fathom how these kind of things can occur in the greatest country in the world. So we're going to continue to work towards that. And as a piece of this, I wanted to come in and really speak to the partnership that we are committed to have with you. And as we start to really flow into an operational period, we have more of a pattern to see what we're doing day in and day out. I'm going to commit to you to have a morning briefing every day at 10 o'clock right here in this location. As you can imagine, some of those briefings may be longer than others, but I want you to know that you're going to see us in the morning. And we're going to go over what happened overnight, and we're going to kind of talk about what the plan of the day is. And I'll speak to that plan of the day here in just a second. I would also say that we will certainly be considering afternoon briefings as well. If something new came up or something that we believe would be helpful for you to know and the communities to know, then we'll get back to you. Either way, you will receive a communication from our PIO, Shannon Moss, either saying we're going to have a briefing or we're not, so that you kind of have some idea what your day and your afternoon is going to look like as well. So I would also say that these daily briefings, as you can imagine, will be more operational in nature, that our families, our communities, our loved ones are always going to be in the forefront of our mind and certainly in our hearts. But we do want to talk to you about this is what we're going to do, this is what we did, because I know that's incredibly important to you. And then you're going to share that appropriately with your viewers, with your readers. And that's going to help everybody start that healing process as well. I know that information is power. You also know that there are going to be times that I won't be able to give you all the information that you need, or certainly that you want. And that won't be done because we're just not going to tell them. That's going to be done because from an operational standpoint or a tactical standpoint, there are safety concerns that I have for our first responders and that we all have for our community members. So please keep that in mind. I will go back to like a Q&A kind of a period. We want to allow that opportunity, and we're going to try to do the best we can. But if in my mind the math starts leading to, well, I'm going to get asked 10 questions and I can't answer 9 of them, then maybe that's counterproductive to a certain extent. So we're going to try to front load as much information as we can, again, with these particular sessions. So that is kind of the plan moving forward. And to speak to today's briefing in particular, I would tell you that the overnight hours, and we are on 24/7, and we will be until the suspect in this case, again, is brought to justice. So overnight, our officers, our investigators, and that's investigating, and I say our, I'm talking about local, county, state, federal, all of our partners, have been continuing to work 530 plus tips and leads that have come in from the general public, from a number of communities, a number of different relationships. And as you can imagine, those vary greatly depending on that individual's knowledge of what happened and what they want us to do about that. So we're continuing to check those things off the list as we go. We're also continuing to do searches at the two primary venues here, the one being Schmenji's Bar and Grill, and the second being the Spare Time Bowling Alley. I will tell you that it's going to be easy to think, well, how come, what's taking them so long to work these scenes, right? And because everything we watch gets solved in an hour, and it's all taken care of. But in order for us to do our jobs, to be professional about what we do, be respectful of the victims and the families that we're working with, and the process within which we work, we have to take our time. We're going to be processing every square inch of these facilities. Not only do you have the victims in question, but every one of those rounds that got fired need to be investigated. Every one of those cartridges that lays on the ground needs to be collected. The vehicles that are in those parking lots, everything that we do around this, we need to be careful. We need to be professional, and that's what we're committed to do. So I would expect that we're still days away from completing those particular investigations, those particular crime scenes. So you'll continue to see us at those locations without question. And because of that, there are also affidavits, and affidavits are essentially the first step in a search warrant or an arrest warrant or whatever that looks like. So we're continuing to draft affidavits ultimately for search warrants around any kind of digital media that we're hoping to attain or investigate. That could be phones, that could be computers, that could be video from any location. So our officers, our investigators continue to work on that material. And so that's a lot of that stuff overnight, as well as using that 3 o'clock, that 4 o'clock in the morning, using that time frame to kind of plan out what the next day is gonna look like. So we've tried to get some people rotated through for operational periods. We're gonna get them some rest. Now let's plan what the next day is gonna look like. We have a morning briefing, which it kind of kicks off and says, this is what's gonna happen. We need a team to go do this. We need a team to go do that. This is who our team leads are. This is the process. And then we let those folks loose to go do the good work. And we're gonna try to share some of that information with you. So as we discuss that, we have some maps and some other additional information up here with us right now. I will talk about a couple of these locations here to the best of my ability. Obviously there's a lot of us here, and this isn't ideal as far as these maps go. But if you look at this boat launch overview as an example, this dot here is that Lisbon boat launch area that we've discussed. That's where the suspect's vehicle was located ultimately, that white Subaru station wagon. And I will also say that we'll have these three primary maps, but this QR code here, and whether you can get it from your seats or come up after the fact, we'll give the digital version of those so you have those readily available. You certainly understand how all of that works. So we talk about that boat launch area, and that particular location is 501 Lisbon Street. Pajebscot Landing is at this location. I believe we have some some of our friends from the media that are out in that area now. And what will happen in this general location today is that we will be putting divers in the water along that Androscoggin River, which you see here. And that's going to look like a couple of different things. So the very first thing that you're going to see out there is you're going to see some air resources that will fly over this particular area. And they're looking to see what can we clear from the air. Do I have to put divers in that particular area, or can I tell from the top, based on the current and how muddy the water is and all those other things, can I see to the very bottom here? So that's going to start this entire process. Then there's going to be some screening and some divers that are actually in the water that may start on this side by the boat launch and will continue on this side. I would envision at some point that we'll be moving over to these particular locations here for ground searches as well. So that's gonna look like a bunch of different things. So they could be dragging a diver behind them, literally, while that diver is checking for evidence, checking for potential bodies. And I would also say that while this is gonna look like a major focus today with a lot of people, we have a lot of other irons in the fire. So I'm not seer saying that the suspect, we know the suspect is in the water and this is what we're doing. What I'm telling you is you're gonna see a lot of activity here, and I'm gonna tell you that in advance. We've got nothing to hide in that regard at all. So then you're gonna have some sonar as well that's gonna be utilized here. And that can look like a couple of different things. A remote operating vehicle, an ROV, is divers could use that. And that will look like a pod under the water. And that is looking for sonar, so picking up shadows, if you will, of what does that look like? Could be a log, could be anything under there. And our divers, that dive team, and that when I say, again, our divers, that's going to be teams from all over the place. Our Maine Warden Service is heavily involved in this. We work with them all the time. The Maine State Police dive team will be in the water and will be leading this initiative. So that's what we'll see here with a couple of different kinds of sonar. And then along the shoreline, you're going to see a line search, if you will. That means literally officers on line as they're working that shoreline. And of course, they're looking for evidence. They're looking for everything, anything that may help them down the road. Now, I say you'll see this because for us, we want to make sure that we're working with you. So there is a church parking lot across the road here. And there's also some parking available on this side of the road. Mark Laddie, who is the PIO from the Maine Warden Service, and some officers will be in this area to assist. So if you decide that you want to go to that location to pick up video and see what they're up to, then I think there's some parking opportunities here. This 196 can be busy. This area here happens to be pretty low speed. At least that's what the speed limit is. So we're going to be around there to try to keep that as safe as possible. But we want you to be mindful that we may ask you not to stand on a railroad trestle, or, you know, we want you to get your coverage. We want to be partners with you. However, you're not going to be able to have full access to that site. I think that's common sense. And we want to make sure that you can do your jobs and we can help you facilitate that. So you're going to see a bunch of people in that area, that 531 Lisbon Road. A couple of these other locations, if we start here, this is the bowling alley scene. This red dot is actually where that is. You all understand that. We will have some additional officers there checking this wood line continuing to do those sweeps, those searches. There was a lot of shots fired in these locations. We want to make sure we have all the evidence humanly possible. And then this is far from ideal, considering it's directly behind the podium. But this is, can we do that? We're jammed in here with the wall. Yeah, we may lean towards that QR code. If you can't see that, I apologize. We'll have to take a look at this particular option in the future if this works for us. But the bar and grill here, there is a red dot, and you can see some wood line around that. Each one of these locations is going to have lots of police officers there, as you imagine. A piece of all of these things will have a QRF, or a quick reaction force. So we're going to maintain security here because clearly, as you realize, the suspect in this case is not in custody. That continues to be our focus. And I think if you look at these two things, we have an investigative bucket with a great deal of resources that are investigating the crime, what occurred. And there's clearly an apprehension team here with a lot of folks that are involved in that. And of course, they're going to intermingle. That's a given. But I think in this scenario, I want you to keep those two things in mind, because even though we're going to be active with this search and the investigative side, always in our mind, we're going to be looking for the suspect and making sure that the people that are involved in these various searches, to include yourselves, are safe. So that is clearly another focus that we have in mind. I would also like to talk about, if we talk about procedures, you talk about practices. There was a lot of activity last night from members of the media in Bowdoin. And what I would tell you is that I'm showing you these three locations. There's a bunch of others that we're going to be working on. And that's not, so we don't have 50 maps up here. We're just going to be working on other locations. And that's not meant to be secretive. That's just to tell you that we're going to be all over the place. That's not saying that we know that the individual is in this house, or we know the individual is in that house, or they're in that swath of land, this acreage. That's not what we're doing. But we do look at all these situations as if the individual could be in there. And if that's the case, you'll see tactical teams at some point. A lot of folks are just dressed in a more casual manner, or a BDU, a battle dress uniform, just because they're going to be out in the woods and they're going to be out crawling around. So that doesn't mean, just because we're making announcements on a, over a PA system, that the individual is in there and we have an armed standoff and there are police swarming. There's just a lot of resources that it takes to work these scenes, right? I mean, I think that part of it, again, is common sense. And we want to be as forthright as we can around that as well. We won't be able to say every time we're hitting a location, hey, we're going to be at this spot, and because that's just not practical. And it's not safe for a lot of folks. So if you hear announcements in PA systems, as an example, a piece of that is us just giving notification that, yes, in fact, we are the police. We are going to be knocking on this door. We would like you to come out if you're in there. Some of that is case law oriented. Some of that is best practice. And some of that's just standard operating procedures from our end. So keep that in mind. If you have a question, you can certainly reach out to Shannon Moss. Many of you have. And if we can answer it, we will. And it may not be immediate, but we're going to do the best we can to do that. And I think we'll be better at that, again, as we kind of get into this flow. Now we know what we're working with. It's starting to settle in as much as a tragedy like this can. And again, we want to be good partners with you across the board. So let me just take a look to make sure I've covered everything that I wanted to cover. I would also say that this is a big deal here, this particular link. And Shannon will be sending that out through her media list. So this is a digital tip line. And what a digital tip line would mean is anybody, yourselves included for whatever reason, if you've got a photo, if you've got a video of what happened, or you know, something that you think is evidentiary in nature, you'd think that it would be valuable for us to have, you can upload that information through that link. And that link stems from best practice in other communities where tragedies like this have occurred, that a lot of people have a lot of information. Where does it go? Maybe this is the key. I don't think they know that. Or they probably do know that. 75 other people sent it to them. Send it to us anyway. And we want to see that information. So that's pictures, that's video, that's any of that kind of material to that particular link. And again, the QR code is something that we already talked about from a mapping perspective. I would say that our ongoing victim services efforts, that is something that that we're working with victims' families, the community as a whole, and we are working with families that have currently been notified. We're continuing to identify victims in this case, and as those occur, additional resources will be available to the general community. I would say, again, as a little bit of a reminder, some searches you may see, well, why does that search have an armored vehicle involved, and then they're walking along the river, you know, shoulder to shoulder. Some of those are going to be tactical ground searches versus just the kind of standard line search or grid search. The Maine Warden Service do this stuff all the time. They're incredible searching for people, and incredibly valuable for us as it kind of expands out to evidence in many of these circumstances. We do clearly continue to have air assets, whether that's helicopters or planes. Just because they're involved, again, as we mentioned here, right, that's going to be an overview. They're just flying over that site. It may be hovered someplace else. Is that because we found the suspect? That's not a guarantee that that's the case at all. I would also tell you probably new information. Initially, that first night, we had 70-ish or so witnesses. The FBI has been incredibly helpful with things that may sound as simple as you've got to transcribe 70-plus witness statements. They're bringing a lot of resources to play. And so we're continuing to do a lot of that work behind the scenes as well. I think that the shelter in place order, right, that's currently in place for Lewiston, Auburn, Lisbon, and Bowdoin. When you hear the names of those communities, obviously you know that a lot of our focus, a lot of what occurred in those communities, whether it's Bowdoin because that's where the suspect's house was, Lisbon where the car was located, or Lewiston, Auburn, some conversation earlier about Auburn locations, and Lewiston where the focus of those first two tragic active shooter situations occurred. That's an ongoing conversation that we'll have every minute of every day. Does it make sense that those orders are still in place? And can we relax those, change those? They have not been changed in any way at this point. But we realize that we want to keep our community safe. So that's the forefront of our minds. But we know that a shelter in place order in general, similar to orders around COVID, can have some negative impacts on families and going to school and businesses and all those other things. So we have that in our mind. There is that pluses and minuses chart that's just kind of active as we kind of work through this thing. So know that we are actively thinking about that. And truth be told, working with specifically right here in Lewiston, working with our officials, working with Chief St. Pierre, working with the mayor and others, having conversations about what does that mean, and what is that going to look like this afternoon, tomorrow, and in moving forward. So I think that's enough sharing from my end. That's a lot of information to overload you with there. I would want to come back, however, to say that there's a lot of stuff going on here, but what matters to us, again, is the safety of our communities, the safety of our residents. We care about each and every one of them, as you do, and we're going to continue to fight on their behalf to bring this individual to justice, because we know that that has an impact on starting that healing process. It's not a slam dunk. It's not, we got them, now everybody's better. This is going to take a while. Right? It's going to take a while for communities to work through. It's going to take forever for families to work through. You lose somebody that you loved. That's a big, big deal. So I don't want to get lost in the minutiae of this is what we're doing, and this is a map, and it's a QR code. It always comes back to this other stuff for us. So again, we're going to try the Q&A deal and see where we go. Go ahead, right here. Yeah, so we've heard the same thing, and there was a note at one of these residences. I'm not prepared to really talk about what that included. And I think that's probably, again, a common sense answer, because that does involve, is there a mindset here? Is there a motive? What did that entail? So we'll definitely continue to work on that. And when we can release it, we certainly will.
Sir.
Right here, sir. Well, I think the one of the possibilities is key, right? Because clearly we don't have him located at this point. We don't have him in custody. So all of those options are on the table. We certainly don't want to wait too long, because the river is a big piece of this. The car was located there. Evidence is located in the vehicle or right there along the shores of the Androscoggin River. So that's stuff that we want to make sure that we're checking, and we're using the resources that we have available. We're using the expertise that we have available with the dive team and all our partners to make sure we're checking that at the same time, right? We're checking all these other things. We're working through the crime lab on this other information. So all of those things are occurring at the same time. I would also state, and I want to make sure that I say this because they've been very, very helpful. The Brookfield Power Company owns two dams, operates two dams in this area. And they've been very cooperative. You know, they live it every day. So as an example, one of the things that we're doing, the river currently runs at like 8,500 cubic square feet per second. And when they tighten the dam tools down. They actually lower that down to like 5,500 cubic feet, right? Does that mean anything to you? What it means to us is that that current, if we can slow that current down, we can lower the amount of water in the river. It's certainly easier for us to work. It's easier for our divers to see in clearer water than muddier water. If it's a foot lower than it was before, it's easier for us to work. And there's different searches, obviously, but unfortunately, people lose their lives and bodies of water on a regular basis. So this is something that we're trying to dial in. But yes, sir, right here. You, yep.
Deer hunting starts tomorrow.
Yeah, it sure does. Yep.
Yeah. Can you address that?
Yeah, sure. So I had conversations with Commissioner Camuso of Inland Fisheries and Wildlife. Judy's great. We are having those conversations. I would expect to hear more about that later in the day. It's a big deal in Maine. It may not be a big deal for a lot of people from other communities, but we know what that's going to look like. We also know we're in the woods. You know, if you just happen to be in the woods, minding your own business, going for a walk, that's going to make us a little concerned, right? So it's definitely a good question. It's something that we're actively working on. Right here, sir.
You talk about this tremendous amount of assets here yep. and the search for him. Can you talk about the pressure you guys are feeling to find him to give this community some sense of answers as this enters his third day?
Yeah, sure. I think, you know, pressure is one way to put it. I mean, we're concerned about the victims, their families, and our communities. I'm concerned every day, 24/7, 365, at this point for 30 years. That's why I got into this business. We do want to help people. We do want to make them safe. Making them safe and making them feel safe may not necessarily be the same thing either, right? Because I think our law enforcement partners, our first responders around the state, everybody is dialed in. They do that all day, every day. This is clearly a completely different animal. So for us, we want to make sure that we bring this individual to custody. But we got to do it right. We got to do it the safe way. Don't want to see anybody else get hurt, certainly our people and our community members. So we want to make sure that we do that right. We're not going to be rushed, but we're running right on that level, that we're going to work as hard as we can, as fast as we can, with as many resources as we can to try to bring some kind of closure.
Here.
Right here, ma'am.
We understand that the family is being cooperative. What are they telling you?
Oh, I think whether you see the 530 tips and leads overall, I think we're seeing a lot of cooperation across the board. I'm not going to speak to anybody in particular, but I think there's a lot of cooperation. There's a lot of compassion here. There's empathy that people understand what happened here, not only to the victims, but again, to the state and to our country. So people are coming forward. They are participating in the process, and that's just the nature of the beast. But I'm not sure I answered it, so go ahead and follow up.
Yeah, I'm so sorry.
That's okay.
Specifically the family of the suspect, we understand yeah. they are cooperating. What are they telling you and how are they helping you in the investigation?
Yeah, so I won't speak, again, specifically to what anybody said one way or the other, but we do appreciate everybody's cooperation because we know that this is difficult for everybody. No matter how you could be the neighbor of somebody. This is tough for people to digest and to understand and to try to work through.
So that's a good
one. Right here, sir, right here.
Thank you very much, sir. Yep. Specifically warning, forget about information. Family has told multiple news outlets that there were warnings provided to law enforcement. Which agencies received those warnings, and did you think at any point that it might warrant a yellow flag pursuit?
Well, I'm heavily involved in the yellow flag conversation overall, but the reality for today is I'm not going to talk specifically about who knew what and when. We're still actively involved in a very dynamic situation here, and we're focused on an individual that currently has 8 warrants out for murder. We're trying to figure that part out, trying to bring him into justice, as well as investigate this crime. There will be a time
when we're... Can you confirm the warning, though? Can you confirm... Warnings were issued.
I cannot. I cannot confirm that one.
So, yesterday, the senator, Senator McConnell, said that the yellow flag law should have been enforced in this situation. So, as you stand here today, what is your response to that? And also, as you stand here today, was law enforcement notified of the threats mm-hmm. that he was making of his condition? Were they aware of it, and what steps were taken to investigate that?
Yeah, I appreciate the question. And Senator Collins is great. We have a great federal delegation that works incredibly hard on behalf of the state of Maine. I don't know exactly what the good senator said. I respect her a great deal. So I won't answer to any comments that she made. If that's her perspective, based on what she knows through the general public or otherwise, then that's fine. She certainly has the right to do that. But based on what I've seen, we're going to continue to work through that. We asked good questions. It may even have been you, sir, around the firearm itself. And there's going to be an opportunity. The ATF is here. The ATF is working with us. They have been there since the first second. There's going to be an opportunity to answer all those questions and figure out, so was that a violation or not? It's also an opportunity from an educational standpoint to talk about what that really means, what that really looks like, and what the options, in fact, are.
I'm going to go over here, though, sir.
So I appreciate the follow-up and the initial question.
You talked about timeline yesterday, 911 calls. Do you have the time, precise times that police arrived on the scene?
Arrived, no. So it was 6:56 for the initial call, and then 7:08 for the second call. Multiple calls for each location. And so that's what I had. I don't know exactly when they arrived, other than to say these calls in any scenario are a priority, to say the least. So everybody's going, and they're going as fast as humanly possible. I'm not done answering the first question. So was that enough, sir? Does that make sense on that? I will take a look at the arrival time so that we have that information, and we may be able to provide that at a different. And I would say this, okay? The way this is going to work, just so we're all clear, the way this is going to work is if we have a Q&A and you ask me questions and I attempt to answer them, as soon as we start yelling over each other, I'm done, just so we're clear. And we don't want to do that. We're trying to be as cooperative as we can across the board, but we'll be back another time, and we're just trying to figure that out. Yes, sir, right here.
Thank you. We're coming up on 48 hours. Hmm? Are you concerned the trail is growing cold?
I think that every minute that this goes on, we're more and more concerned, because what's the next thing that's going to happen? And we understand that. And that's why we're working 24/7 to bring this individual to justice and to try to bring some closure and overall safety to our communities. So, yes, we feel that just as much as the community member does or any of us. This is a privilege. This is an honor we have to do something about these tragedies when they occur. In many instances, I've been in those scenarios. This happens out of state. You're sitting on your couch wishing you could do something to help. Well, we're in a position to do something to help, and we will. There's no question in my mind that we will bring this individual into custody one way or the other. I'm going to take one more question from you, sir, and then we're going to be done.
Can you confirm that you've identified 16 out of the 18 bodies? And if so, can you confirm the demographics, please?
Yeah, and I think that that may be a question. The specifics may be a question for a future briefing. We have identified and notified the families of 8 of the 18 fatalities that were involved in this incident. We mentioned those 8 murder warrants, and the reason why we have 18 victims, we only have 8 of those warrants. That's because 8 of those people have been identified, and 8 of those people, the families, have been notified, which is certainly key for us to make sure we get that right. But further demographics around that, the colonel gave gender yesterday, and we'll take a look at ages and some other information. I'd like to be able to. So I'd like to be able to honor the group of victims by talking about them in a specific session that I would be view coming shortly. 8 of the 18 have been identified and notified, not 16, and I don't know where that came from. So thank you very much. I do appreciate it. We will see you again along the way. Thank you.